Hello, my name is Richard Harmon, and I lead our financial services vertical globally. Thank you for joining us to discuss operational resiliency in banking. This is a key area for ensuring stability and trust in today's rapidly changing landscape. Let's dive into some specific strategies and challenges. With me, I have two great speakers. Could you please introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm Monique Hesseling, and I'm Red Hat's Global Financial Services Digital Transformation Lead, and I am based in London.
Hi, I'm Monique Hesseling, and within the Global Financial Services team, I oversee our efforts in the insurance industry, and I'm based just outside of Philadelphia in New Jersey.
Wonderful. So let me start with Monica. With global regulations increasingly shaping cloud usage, particularly concerning third-party risk, vendor lock-in, and the risk of public cloud workloads, how can adopting a hybrid cloud platform help banks address these issues?
Thanks, Richard. It is well known, as you say, that there's a lot of complexity within existing IT estates, data centers, et cetera, and that the public cloud has been almost a tonic to simplifying using existing infrastructure. But actually, it's added complexity because it has created yet another technology silo or island, if you will. Add this to the regulatory requirements to have a plan B, which is essentially what a lot of the operational resilience rules are about, for all critical third-party ICT providers. And we're seeing many of our clients getting fed up with this complexity and are seeking a single standardized platform that they can run anywhere on any silicon architecture. So the more complex an IT estate is, the harder it is to monitor. And of course, the harder it is to mitigate threats and identify vulnerabilities. This is where having that consistent platform across the open hybrid cloud becomes more appealing because it removes risks when modernizing and integrating the new technologies with the older ones. So in short, the open hybrid cloud allows firms to connect their public cloud and private clouds to reduce operational costs and improve resiliency by enabling application portability and netting a single pane of glass to operate.
Thank you. That was a fantastic discussion. Monique, balancing resilience with cost management is essential. What are some effective ways for banks or even financial market infrastructure players are looking at to enhance operational resiliency and create value?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, Richard, because what we often see is that operational resilience initiatives are being viewed as a cost, right? Either security reasons or government compliance forces are perceived to be forcing companies to do something. I think that's wrong because, yes, it is an expense outlay, of course. But as Monica mentioned earlier, it does give organizations a great opportunity to modernize and to implement a better functioning platform that not only is benefiting operational resilience or compliance with regulations, but also can help with know their customers kind of initiatives, better marketing, better sales. So I do think that we need to shift the conversation from operational resilience is a cost-driven security / regulatory compliance effort into, yes, we have to do these things, but we also can use these investments in an OpenShift or in an Ansible or whatever to grow our business and to run our business in a more efficient way.
Excellent. Monica, last question. DORA, the Digital Operation Resiliency Act, is gaining a lot of attention across Europe and the world. How does DORA differ from previous regulations, and what unique considerations does it bring for financial institutions?
So, yeah, it's an interesting question. Well, only for people like me, really, but I find it interesting nonetheless. One of the things that DORA is doing is it's trying to harmonize all of the existing laws and regulations that are already out there. So a lot of the elements of DORA, most firms around the world, but in particular in the EU, have already had to comply to a lot of these elements. But they've had to do them, dare I say, in silos or in a vertical manner, so by a product line, for example. Now they have to do it across the entire organization or the entire enterprise. So that's one big change. In the context of what's going on around the world, you've got the UK operational resilience regime. You also have similar regimes in Australia and New Zealand. But at the core of all, and actually Singapore as well, and Japan, these are the ones that are already kind of out there. The US is trying to knit its own set of regulations together across the country as well. But at the core, all of these rules are about protecting each jurisdiction's financial systems and economies. Because, you know, you might have heard earlier in this recording, digital payments and digital everything isn't going anywhere. So that's really what a lot of these rules are about. In particular, some of the unique things that I think firms or unique considerations institutions need to think about is when they're doing cross-border activity, when they operate in different jurisdictions. In the UK, for example, it's all about understanding your important business services and basically a firm getting to their minimum viable bank. And they want to make sure that whatever happens, if anything goes wrong, there are no intolerable levels of harm done to us as consumers or clients. Right? So it's the client at the center of all of it. It just wants to make sure that the economy can keep going and that people essentially don't lose their money or are able to transact with their bank. The EU, on the other hand, the DORA, is more of a framework. It's more framework driven. So it does mandate having, you know, huge frameworks and infrastructure, different use of the word infrastructure, to manage third party and ICT information and communications technology providers' risk. So, and that's huge. So those are kind of where firms, I think, have these sort of almost not quite competing, but different lenses of how they can look to keep their firms up and running and their businesses up and running so that we as consumers can access our finances and transact.
Right. Well, thank you, Monica and Monique, for sharing your insights. I think this will be very, very illustrative for everyone who's listening. And thank you again for joining this event.
You're welcome. Pleasure.